So we spend years and years focusing on books and tutorials that only talk about labeled data and how crucial it is to build supervised machine learning models. The reality is different. Labeled data does not exist in the real world. So as soon as you go out there and try to get a job, problem number one for you is, what is my data and who's creating these labels? Here's the thing, labeling data is really, really hard. Let's make sure I say that very, very clearly. And it's funny because without labels, there's no model. Fortunately, there is a solution. But before I get there, let me show you something. With that out of the way, let's get back into it. The solution to our problem is actually very simple. We need to build a model to label the data we need to build a model. Now, I know that sounds a whole lot like the chicken and egg problem. How are we going to label data to build a model that we need to label the data in the first place? Like, what comes first, the labels or the model? But I have good news. Who says that we need all of the data to build a model? Think about how many duplicated samples we are going to find. How many samples are not going to contribute a ton to our model? We don't need any of that. Potentially, for all we know, we can get away with, let's say, 30% of our data set and build a good performing model just with those labels. And this leads us to the first critical insight of this video. Let's start with the simplest solution we could possibly imagine. Let's randomly grab 30% of our entire data set, label it, and build a model with that information. So let me show you really quick. Imagine that this is 30% of my data set, and we build a model that goes like this. Now, this is what I want you to think about. There are many, many different possibilities for this particular model. I could have done this, maybe this, or maybe this. We just don't know because the 30% of samples that we picked are not good enough to determine where this model is going to be. So unfortunately, as we saw, depending on which samples we choose, our model might look very, very different, might not even work. At best, whenever we select samples randomly, we should expect a mediocre model. So this leads us to insight number two of this video. And here is where active learning comes in. It's a process that I love to simplify into four different components. The kickoff. During the kickoff, we're gonna get a tiny percentage of our data set, not the 30% that we talked about. That's the maximum number of samples we want to label. Just a tiny percent, maybe 2-3%, depending on how much data you have. We're gonna get that data, we're gonna label it, and we're gonna build a very, very rough version of our model. Something to start things up. As soon as we have this model, we're ready to get into component number two, inference. So now we have a rough model and we have a bunch of samples in our data set without labels. We're gonna use this model to create the predictions for every one of those samples. And we're gonna organize all of that data in a table that looks like this. So here are the results that we get from running our first initial version of a model through the entire data set that doesn't have labels. We're gonna get a potential prediction that we shouldn't trust right now, and we're gonna get the confidence. And if you look at this, you will notice that I sorted this table by the confidence. So predictions at the top have a higher confidence than the predictions at the bottom. With this information, we're ready to go to component number three, sampling. Think about which of these samples do you think will contribute the most to our model. Like the high confidence samples, our model is clearly very good at predicting those samples. Labeling those samples will contribute next to nothing to our model. We want to focus on the low confidence sample because our model is clearly having trouble coming up with the answer, has very low confidence on those predictions. So labeling handling those samples will probably contribute the most to our model. That's what we want to do. That's where we want to focus all of our labeling efforts. This labeling approach is called uncertainty sampling because we are using the uncertainty of our model to decide which samples we should label next. And this is the perfect segue for the final component of active learning, component number 4, retrain. We started with a rough model, used it to predict the entire data set, grabbed the samples with lower confidence, labeled them, and now we can use these new labels to retrain a new version of our model. And we can use this new version to start the process all over again. And when we get there, this model will certainly be better than the model we built using random samples from our data set. And that gets us to the third and final insight of this video. Now, of course, I simplified the whole explanation of active learning and focused only on key aspects of it. There's more you can check on the paper that I'm gonna link in the description below, from sampling ideas to how to deal with real-time data. But the core idea, the fundamental insight, the key principle of active learning stays the same. If we can choose the data we label, we can build a good performing model with just a fraction of our data set.